Greetings, colleagues, students, and staff, and our attendees who are joining by webcast from across the U.S. I am Dr. Julie Kieser, director of the BU Center for Enhancing Activity and Participation Among Persons with Arthritis, or ENACT, and an associate professor of physical therapy and athletic training at Boston University. ENACT is based at the College of Health and Rehabilitation Sciences on the BU Charles River campus. And ENACT is a highly interdisciplinary program with faculty and investigators from the School of Public Health, the School of Medicine, the College of Health and Rehabilitation Sciences, and the School of Communication. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Patience White, Vice President of the Public Health at the Arthritis Foundation, Professor of Medicine and Pediatrics at the George Washington University School of Medicine and Health Sciences, and a consultant to the Health and Human Services Bureau of Maternal and Child Health's Medical Transition National Center. Dr. White is joining us today as a visiting professor and member of ENACT's Scientific Advisory Board. Her talk today is titled, Moving National Public Health Agendas to Action, Pitfalls, Challenges, and Opportunities. Specifically, she will talk about the OA Public Health Agenda and ongoing interagency activities to bring the agenda to reality in the community. Dr. White has a Master of Science degree from Dartmouth Medical School, a Doctor of Medicine degree from Harvard Medical School, and a Master's in Education from George Washington University Graduate School of Education and Human Development. Dr. White joined the Arthritis Foundation in 2004, and ever since she has been an advocate for people with arthritis and increased the Arthritis Foundation's public health visibility nationally. She led the Arthritis Foundation to obtain two multi-million-dollar CDC cooperative agreements to assist the Arthritis Foundation in reaching people with arthritis. She is facilitating two public health strategic activities for the Arthritis Foundation, having arthritis recognized as a major public health issue in the United States, and leading new strategic objectives to reduce arthritis-related disparities in health and health care. Again, we welcome our virtual attendees, and we have a great representation across the U.S. from public health departments, public health schools, practitioners, and consumer organizations. And we'll see if I can go back up to the beginning here. Okay.
Great. Thank you very much, Julie. It's really a great pleasure to be here today and have a chance to come here and spend a day with ENACT. I really appreciate being invited and being a part of the scientific committee. So today I have the chance to sort of tell you the story of how the Arthritis Foundation, with lots of partners and help, are trying to sort of move a national public health agenda to action around arthritis. So I'm going to be telling you that story today, but starting a little bit with some other components here. Just to have people be familiar with arthritis, I'm going to talk about arthritis and a little bit why it's a public health issue. Many people ask me that question. And then learn about the Arthritis Foundation's approach to using the National Public Health Agenda for Osteoarthritis, the OA Action Alliance, the Ad Council campaign, the environmental policy strategies, and the Institute of Medicine's Living Well with Chronic Illness report, all of these things, to really approach this crisis and begin to make a difference in the public health arena. I'll be talking about some of the challenges and many of the opportunities that we've had moving this forward. So I'm always asked, what is arthritis? And the word arthritis really means joint inflammation. And it comprises lots of different diseases. People are often surprised about that, as well as many other conditions. The most common are osteoarthritis, gout. Many people are familiar with gout and osteoarthritis, as well as rheumatoid arthritis. The common symptoms include pain, aching, stiffness and swelling in and around the joints. It has a tremendous impact on the United States as well as in business. There are 50 million people diagnosed with arthritis. That means one in five of the people in this auditorium and listening to here are likely to have arthritis. And that by 2030, it's going to climb to 67 million people. Two-thirds of these people with arthritis are under the age of 65. That usually surprises people that so many younger people have arthritis. And it's the second most frequently reported chronic condition. It is the leading cause of disability, and it has significant activity limitations. 21 million report activity limitations, and that will also grow to 25 million by 2030. There are 8 million, one in three report work limitations, so it has a significant impact on the workplace. And it's more frequent cause of activity limitation than many of the other chronic illnesses that people always refer to, heart disease, diabetes, or cancer. It has an enormous cost, and as you can see here, when you add it all up, it's $128 billion. And we know that that figure is low because it needs to be updated, but it's still a tremendous cost to society in terms of financing it. It also affects all racial and ethnic groups. As you can see here, the prevalence seems to be a little bit less in the African American and Hispanic Latino, but there's some question about whether or not many of those people are in the system to get involved in these kinds of wonderful surveillance that the CDC does. Certainly that is what the Hispanic community tells me, since two-thirds are undocumented and probably not involved in getting involved in the calls and the ways that they look for people with arthritis. But you can see, despite this, that the activity limitation, work limitation, and pain is more common in these groups. We don't know why this is, but clearly this is another issue that in the United States, as the population shifts and the Hispanic Latino population becomes the leading group that's growing in this country, we need to be thinking about that along with our other minority groups. So physical activity in general is a proven benefit for arthritis. People with arthritis often say, really? I don't want to move my joints. It actually increases my pain. But a lot of the studies have been done. It shows that it can decrease pain when the physical activity is done appropriately. It can delay and prevent some disability, improve function, and increase independence. It improves aerobic capacity, muscle strength, and overall quality of life. Yet, people with arthritis still have higher rates of physical inactivity than those without. 44% are inactive. That means they're less than 10 minutes of aerobic activity, physical activity a week, compared to 36% inactive without arthritis. So the barriers are pain, fatigue, lack of mobility and motivation, and I think fear of pain. Arthritis is a very painful condition, and it's the number one issue that people with arthritis speak about. It does have comorbidities. The highest rates of physical activity are also among adults who have arthritis that come along with heart disease, diabetes, and obesity. The hope here is that physical activity done safely with arthritis will help those other diseases. So if people with diabetes become more physically active who are not because of their comorbid arthritis, that you'll begin to improve the disease outcome as well around diabetes. So actually, how many people with diabetes and heart disease have arthritis? As you can see here, that 59% of people with heart disease have arthritis, about 11 million people here. 54% of people with diabetes have arthritis, about 7.3 million people. And about 37% of people who are obese have arthritis. So you see it marches along with these other major public health issues in the country. Now, this is an example just showing you from diabetes here, looking at people who have diabetes alone versus arthritis with diabetes, arthritis alone, and neither condition. So when you're looking with neither condition, you can see the percent inactive, and then you move to, in the next column, arthritis alone, then diabetes alone. But when you have that column on the right, as you look at this, arthritis and diabetes are by far the most highest percent of inactive. So thinking about arthritis becomes very important when you're looking at these other diseases. If you don't really address the arthritis, you're not going to be able to address the other chronic illnesses. So I think it's important. We almost look at arthritis as sort of the backbone issue here, that you really need to be thinking about that. And if you don't address it, you're going to have trouble addressing many of the people with heart disease and diabetes. So the challenge is this triple threat in the United States of obesity, arthritis, and physical inactivity. There is data, and it always really can motivate some people, that just being just 10 pounds overweight can increase the force on the knee by 30 to 60 pounds with every step. And so just a little bit of weight loss can make a huge difference. in arthritis of the knee. And you can see the pain, the cycle pain here, that people have arthritis, they have pain, they tend not to be physically active, they then gain weight, increasing more pressure, and this is sort of a vicious cycle. And when you look over here, you can see that the prevalence increases with body weight pretty directly here, from healthy weight at 16.9%, overweight at 19.8%, and obese at 29.6%. So the public health crisis around obesity also ties in arthritis as we're looking at this. So what do people with arthritis want? They want their pain to be relieved. The Arthritis Foundation has done a lot of work looking around at what and asking people with arthritis what they want. Not only do they want their pain relieved, they want their quality of life to improve. They want the public and the federal government to recognize arthritis as a key issue. They wanted to increase funding to find that cure so arthritis will be gone. And they want to focus the public's attention on what they can do to improve their lives and potentially prevent it. Now the challenges is, well, exactly this. Arthritis is not well understood by the public or policymakers. There's a high morbidity but low mortality, and that sometimes makes people think there's lack of urgency here. The emerging comorbidities are the major focus in public health, and we want arthritis to join those other diseases that are constantly mentioned: heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and obesity. The common myths that people have out there is arthritis pain's not serious. It's not a problem. And anyway, it's just part of aging. You just have to live with it. And finally, when people say living with arthritis, they therefore don't actually find out what kind of arthritis they have and what they can do about it. So there is an opportunity here, and today we're talking about the public health approach here, that something really can be done to get people active and feeling better across the lifespan. And I wanted to let you know a little bit about the Arthritis Foundation before we get looking at what we're doing in this arena. We are the only nationwide agency addressing arthritis and the related conditions. We're a volunteer health organization with about 60 years of experience. We now are organized in 10 regions with great community presence. And it serves as a national resource that people can turn to when they are diagnosed or have arthritis, and is one of the largest private nonprofit contributors to arthritis research in the U.S. We've given about $360 million to support more than 2,100 scientists over the past many years. Our mission is to improve the lives of people with arthritis through the leadership in prevention, control, and cure of arthritis and related diseases. We've set a goal, which is to reduce by 20% the number of people affected by arthritis-related physical activity limitations by 2030. We have good presence in the community around our evidence-based programs. We have a program with the YMCA, an aquatics program. We have an exercise program and a new walk with ease program that is given and put out by our local offices and our partners across the United States, along with the public health departments. And the new signature program, Walk with Ease, I just wanted to let you know about it. It's a physical activity and self-management program designed for people with arthritis and other chronic conditions. It's been evaluated by Dr. Lee Callahan at the Thurston Arthritis Research Center at the University of North Carolina. It's approved by the CDC as an evidence-based intervention. It's available in English and Spanish. It focuses on motivational strategies, action plans, goal setting, social support. It can be done by individuals, self-directed, or groups led by a trained leader, and it's a six-week program. You can see the workbook here that comes along with the program. So when you're thinking about public health, let's just all be on the same page. Sort of, what is a public health intervention? This comes from the National Public Health Agenda for Osteoarthritis. A public health intervention is an activity that prevents disease, injury, or disability, or promotes health in a group of persons. These activities are distinguished from individual clinical intervention. And when we're thinking about having a public health approach at the Arthritis Foundation, we really turned to this wonderful CDC health impact pyramid and began to think about where we are active in these different levels. As you can see here, we're looking at from the smallest impact at the top of this triangle down to the largest impact. And you're starting at the lower part with socioeconomic factors. We all know that poverty, education, housing, and equity affect health. The next is changing the context to make individuals' default decisions to be healthy. You know, these classic examples of the smoke-free laws, the tobacco tax, those kinds of approaches. Then there are long-lasting protective interventions, such as immunizations. Clinical interventions, these are the things that we do in our academic health centers and across the country in physicians' offices. Treating for high blood pressure, high cholesterol, these kinds of diseases. And finally, counseling and education. You know, we want people to eat healthy, be physically active, but it often takes a lot of effort and has not as much impact as some of these other policy areas on the lower part of this triangle. Now, we've had enjoyed a wonderful relationship with the CDC Arthritis Group, and together, they have helped us to be thinking about how to address arthritis as a public health issue. And they do tremendous surveillance data to really make the case about arthritis as a public health issue. And together we've worked on the national public health agenda and the other areas here that I'll be speaking about. Together we want to continue to expand evidence-based programs such as the Walk with Ease program and some of the self-management programs. And the CDC has an arthritis program in many states that also is working on all these areas. So I took that wonderful sort of triangle here and sort of said, what are the arthritis tools leading to outcomes in these areas? And clearly for many years we've worked hard with our evidence-based programs, our community programs and services, conferences, websites, our tools and newsletter. These are excellent modalities. Really are focusing on educating that person with arthritis. In clinical interventions, we've had a long-standing research program I mentioned earlier. We advocate for more arthritis research and prevention, access to biologics and pediatric rheumatologists. What we really wanted to do is begin to think about how we could change the context to make individuals choose the healthy approach and perhaps delay and decrease the disability from arthritis. And many of the things I'm going to talk about today in red here fit in this area. And so that's where we began to turn our focus. So we then turned and thought the first thing we need to do is think about osteoarthritis. It was really the most common form of arthritis. The prevalence is clearly rising. We have 27 million Americans have osteoarthritis. And this is doctor-diagnosed arthritis as done by the CDC. Half of all adults will develop OA of the knee. 60% of people who are obese will develop OA. So we can see that where we're headed, since the country is not getting lighter. As you know, there's been a recent report released where we're going to have many states having more than 60% of their population being obese in the next 10 years. It's the leading cause of pain, loss of function, and disability among adults in Western countries. In the U.S., about 700,000 hip and knee replacements are carried out each year. And about 80% of people with OA have limitations in movement, and 25% cannot perform major activities of daily living. And you can see some of these major activities here from the Framingham cohort. 34% have trouble doing heavy home chores. 30% or so walking a mile, housekeeping, stair climbing. So a significant morbidity for people who have this form of arthritis. So we thought back in 2010 with the CDC that we needed to garner attention. So this is the beginning of our process to be thinking about how to make arthritis recognized as a public health issue. So the National Public Health Agenda for Osteoarthritis, we pulled together 75 stakeholders who collaborated on creating this National Public Health Agenda for Osteoarthritis. It's really a call to action that around the areas that make a difference in public health, and you can see this circle here, weight management, self-management education, physical activity, and injury prevention. And we really wanted to influence this sort of systemic change to improve the lives of Americans with arthritis, in particular osteoarthritis. Now, the recommendations, what we really wanted over the next 5 years is to establish supportive communication initiatives, public health policies, and strategic alliances for OA prevention and management, continue to ensure the availability of evidence-based public health interventions, and initiate public health research to better understand osteoarthritis, its risk factors, and effective strategies for prevention. I'll list some of these here so we can look at the 10 top here. So self-management education should be expanded as a community-based intervention for people with symptomatic OA. Low-impact, moderate-intensity aerobic physical activity and muscle-strengthening exercise should be promoted widely as a public health intervention. We want to decrease joint injury by increasing existing policies and interventions that have been shown to reduce OA-related joint injuries. Many people don't know that if you have a major injury and have to have surgery in your knee, even as a high school student, that you're going to develop osteoarthritis at a high prevalence 10 years later. So you're seeing this increasing, particularly around injury for women in soccer and baseball, as well as basketball. Weight management should be promoted for the prevention and treatment of osteoarthritis, and national nutrition and dietary guidelines for the general population should be followed by people with arthritis so they select the right things to eat, staying within their caloric requirements. And develop a national policy platform for OA should be established to improve the nation's health through evidence-based clinical and community intervention and disease control activities, including core public health infrastructure improvement. Also, to expand systems to deliver evidence-based interventions and make sure there's access to these. They're there. Can everybody actually have the opportunity to take them? Improve workplace environments by adopting policies and interventions that prevent onset and progression of osteoarthritis. Have a well-designed communication strategy that should be initiated and sustained to enhance the understanding, hopefully change attitudes and behavior among everybody, consumers, healthcare providers, policymakers, employers, and the business community and community as well. And last but not least, research and evaluation should be pursued to enhance surveillance, better understand risk factors, refine recommended intervention strategies, and evaluate workplace interventions, and examine emerging evidence on additional interventions. This is a tall order, these 10 recommendations. You can see we have a lot of work ahead of us. So how are we going to, what are the sort of the next steps for us to change that context? We actually launched the OA agenda on Capitol Hill in February of 2010 and delivered it to all the federal and many administration offices. We often see going back to visit them today as they're talking about federal budgets that they bring up this OA agenda, sometimes not knowing it was us with the CDC that created it as examples. We have built and beginning to work with an OA Action Alliance to keep those partners engaged that came together. And we want to communicate with consumers. We partnered with the Ad Council to do a campaign, which I'll show you. We also developed, in conjunction with our partners and the CDC, environmental and policy strategies to increase physical activity among adults with arthritis. And we wanted to think about switching the attention overall to morbidity from arthritis and how to lessen it. I think we tend to measure how we're doing in public health by how many people don't die. I think we need to begin to think about it, and we wanted to begin to have people think about how do you live well with chronic disease. So with the CDC, we helped fund an Institute of Medicine report, what I will also speak about. So what about this OA Action Alliance? Well, its mission is to prevent and control osteoarthritis by promoting effective programs, policies, and communication strategies. We initiated in April 2011, And we have work groups. You can see it's no surprise. These work groups follow very closely the agenda itself. Please, if you want to learn a lot more about this, see www.oaaction.org. This is just giving you the broad-based network of advocates. These are all organizations. And as you see here, the Enact is a member here of the OA Action Alliance. And this is growing, so this is already outdated. We have a new member that joined us today, and we're very excited about this. And each of them have chosen one of those areas to work in as we're going forward. So these work groups, the Injury Prevention Work Group, really is promoting evidence-based policies and strategies, and they're really focusing on ACL tears at the moment and going to be working very focused in that area, and then we'll be turning to thinking about falls in the older age groups. Physical Activity Work Group is increasing physical activity and reducing physical inactivity among adults. Self-Management Education Work Group goal is really to promote evidence-based arthritis, self-management education programs for all adults with arthritis. And the Weight Management Group is promoting policies, initiatives, and partnerships to help all people achieve and maintain a healthy weight. And a lot of this is getting folks in the obesity arena to be thinking about arthritis as associated with obesity, and that perhaps you don't have to get arthritis if you reduced your weight and became a little more healthy in terms of what you're eating. Another component, and we released this the same day we released the osteoarthritis agenda, was the Ad Council campaign. This was an exciting effort to work on. This has been a three-year effort, working with the Ad Council and developing a campaign that would really create a sense of urgency and compel boomers, we're looking at 55 and up, with arthritis to realize that they can take simple steps to change the course of arthritis. Many of you may have heard some of these radio ads. I'll show you some of the posters and so forth. The goal was to drive adults with arthritis to a website. The Ad Council campaign primarily works through the web in terms of their campaigns, where they can learn simple steps to reduce the pain and increase their mobility. And as I said, it's adults 55 and up who have arthritis, living with it, or at risk. So the main message was you can stop arthritis pain taking over your life. And you know, the reason you have to think about this and was really portrayed nicely in these ads going forward is there are simple actions you can take. The more you move, the more you can move. And for every pound lost, there's a 4-pound reduction in the load exerted on each knee. That latter message really spoke to many people. And in all the focus groups, it really would be a showstopper. And we did a lot of focus groups around these messages. There are TV ads. As you can see here, we did a variety. The first one was do pop locking, which is a fun, very movement-oriented activity. It made people smile in the early parts of this campaign. We made it a little more hard-hitting with the latter part of the campaign, talking about your weapon to fight arthritis. You can see here the print ads. The most popular print ad by far is this one. It was a lot of fun to try to find a generic sneaker to make it fit here. And you can see here on here it says use daily to improve your health. And obviously moving is the best medicine. And obviously swimming as well as walking your dog is another approach here as well. We had an active website as you can see here. This was fightarthritispain.org. It's still up there. And you'll note here that we developed a risk assessment tool with our colleagues at the NIH as well as the University of Pittsburgh, Dr. Kent Kuo, that was evidence-based to really help people learn a little bit their risk around knee osteoarthritis here. It has evidence-based questions that was developed, as I mentioned, and validated from the NIH OAI database. The questionnaire was placed on the Ad Council campaign website. We've had about 5,000 people take this assessment to date and become engaged in this process. And it obviously assisted us in being able to reach back out to this group and see how we could get them engaged in the programs and services that the foundation offers. These are some of the sample questions. As you can see, It's pretty straightforward. During the past year, you have had it. Have you had any pain, aching, or discomfort around your knees when squatting? Any time during the past year, have you had knee swelling that lasted more than one day? At any time during the past year, have you felt grinding or heard clicking or any other type of noise when either knee moved? So you can see these are there's more questions there. And what happens when people take this? They then get a rating of low, moderate, or severe risk. And then they can choose information that they can receive to help them think about what to do with regards to their high risk or moderate or low risk. So then we began to think we need to think about policy and systems and environmental change that can be applied to arthritis. There's been a lot of data that, yes, if you were trying to stop people from smoking, that doing environmental and policy change is extremely important. But actually, how do you get people to do something positive, right? How do you want to get people to think? What's the policy change you have to do to make people to do physical activity, for instance? So when you're thinking about this, what are the advantages? Well, it has the potential for, obviously, systemic change, impacting many elements of an organization, changing infrastructure. Has broad reach, you know, ideally leveling the playing field for that group so that they have availability. Flexibility, thinking about the unique characteristics and needs of your community to implement these initiatives. And it's sustainable over the long run. When the champion, even when the champion sort of leaves and funding often is gone. So where you live affects how you live. I think everybody feels this in public health. You simply can't make healthy decisions if healthy options aren't available. So a lot of this is thinking about what we can do to improve physical activity. So just reminding us, we have a daunting task in front of us. The prevalence of no leisure time physical activity among adults with arthritis. From the CDC here, you can see this wonderful dark belt down here where more than 40% of people don't do anything. There are a couple of very healthy states here. I could quiz you here which ones those are, but you can see that we have a daunting task to try to make a difference here in this process. So we started the process by developing policy environmental strategies to increase physical activity. This is a report that focuses on the unique role of physical, social, and environmental factors in making physical activity accessible, convenient, and effective for adults with arthritis. That's a tall order. And we pulled together excellent experts from many of the factors, many of the sectors out there that would help us think through what would really be arthritis specific. There are many good policies around disability programs and so forth, but we were trying to focus on what was particular for people with arthritis. It was funded by a CDC grant, brought together these experts. It reviewed the strategies to assist people with arthritis. And developed a report for six sectors for professionals. And you can see these sectors are going to be no surprise. It mirrors the HHS approach as well. So these fit together well. Community and public health, health care, transportation, land use, and community design, business and industry, park recreation, fitness and sports, mass media, and communications. The recommendations had to be practical and doable, likely to have the greatest impact on adults with arthritis, able to be initiated in 1 to 2 years, but clearly would take many years to fully complete, and sustainable over time. These are tall order things that we had to be thinking about when these recommendations were pulled together. So here are some of the top priority recommendations in these different sectors. So in community and public health, invest resources to deliver these evidence-based physical activity programs for adults with arthritis. Make them available for as many people as possible. In healthcare, one of the top ones that people felt was to ask arthritis patients about physical activity levels at every visit. Make it a vital sign. Make it something that people focus on. In transportation, land use, and community design, promote active living environments that can support adults with arthritis being physically active. Is that park, is that area conducive for somebody with arthritis to be able to become physically active? For that matter, is there a park, is there a place for you to be physically active nearby? business and industry, incorporate the needs of adults with arthritis into the worksite wellness programs without requiring disclosure. A lot of people don't want to disclose they have arthritis, so it's important to have these programs available for them and that they don't have to disclose. In the park, recreation, fitness, and sport, make certain that parks and rec, fitness and sport professionals are trained on how to adapt and modify physical activity programs and exercises for people with arthritis. And then mass media and communication, promote these evidence-based physical activity interventions through signage, media promotion, and public outreach. So you've got a sense of the top, but there are many more recommendations. There are many that people could do quickly that are not so daunting. So I commend people to going to see the report. It can be found at www.arthritis.org/physical-activity. We had a Capitol Hill briefing, and it didn't take but 1 minute to get all these people to jump on board. We basically announced that we had this available, and people just called us up and said, can we co-sponsor this with you? So we have a lot of interest around this issue in trying to get people with arthritis to become physically active. So what are the next steps here? Much of the implementation efforts of this report is being led by the OA Action Alliance Physical Activity Workgroup. There's a large group of organizations that have come together that are going to think about where should they focus. And one of the leaders in this is now the National Park and Rec Association, who is going to be working very hard at thinking about incorporating some of the arthritis evidence-based programs across the nation. Collaborate with these six sectors to institute many of the strategies. We're reaching out to some of these sectors to say, how can we work together? Some insurance companies and other employers, as well as many other of the sectors. We are creating an implementation guide to help our regions, as well as others and state health departments, to think about how to, what are the next steps here? This seems like such a daunting process to make a policy change. And obviously find additional partners. How are we going to know we've made a difference here? We want to see how many of the recommendations are enacted over the next 5 to 10 years. And the number of people with arthritis who actually are more active. And the CDC is going to be our person looking over our shoulder and telling us how we're doing. Finally, one of the things I mentioned here is that we wanted to change the attention on to morbidity, of not mortality. How could one do that? That's a daunting approach as well. And I think many of you are familiar with the Institute of Medicine. They did the quality chasm. They actually raised the issue of how many people are dying in hospitals and how lethal hospitals can be. So they have a voice out there, and it's really one that everybody listens to. So with the CDC, we funded the Institute of Medicine to really look at this, to look at how we could make living well with chronic illness the focus, not who's dying and are we stopping death a little bit. They actually took a very broad view, which is very exciting, and I commend people to look at this report. They took 9 months and published Living Well with Chronic Disease in February of 2012. They actually had a very inclusive definition of chronic illness, and they included many illnesses of all causes, but really brought out exemplary diseases, and arthritis was one of them. We were pleased that rose to that level. They wanted attention to disadvantaged and minority populations, sort of these underlying themes. The need to understand the natural history of chronic illnesses across the life course. And brought out, I think, the complex interface of public health and clinical chronic disease management. Time and time again, people mention, well, you know, you spend a very little time at your doctor's office. You spend most of your time in the community. And we should be thinking about those links loud and clearly to help people to continue what they're learning when they see their healthcare provider. And obviously a greater inclusion of quality of life measures and national outcome measures. Now, I'm not going to go over it, but there is this wonderful also pyramid, thinking about what you can do that they recommend a little bit. And when they're talking about whole population at the lower part of this pyramid here, They talked about developing environmental population-based policy interventions. And you can see we're beginning that with the environmental and policy strategies to increase physical activity. So that's one of the things that we are beginning to do. And looking at for persons with high risk of chronic conditions and chronic diseases, looking at community-wide strategies that link the health care to support self-care and provide risk factor treatments and prevention of complications. Those who are impaired or disabled have intensive strategies aligning healthcare and non-healthcare sectors. That's a link to the community. And finally, I love the aged. That's a word that makes all of us and the baby boomers feel very, very old. But the aged, disadvantaged, and minorities, having high-intensity interventions designed to address the unequal burden of chronic diseases in this group. So this is a beginning with the IOM report. It is a very exciting report for us to think broadly about what we should be doing and linking the many aspects that somebody with chronic disease interfaces with in the delivery system across the community as well as the healthcare delivery system. So just to review, you can see where we headed. With the help of the CDC and many of our partners here, we began to move to changing the context. That's really where we were beginning to think we needed to take that opportunity and move in that arena, at the same time trying to keep our presence with community programs, evidence-based programs, and the research and the other wonderful things that the foundation does. So what about the observations on the process so far? Well, we're actually pleased that the recent MMWR stated that people with arthritis actually increased walking. We thought that was exciting. We hoped that our Ad Council campaign and some of the things that we did made a little bit of difference, though that came in at the latter part of this. And note that actually people with diabetes did not increase as much as people with arthritis as well in this recent MMWR. So what about the other observations? Well, clearly collaborative strategies are more creative than any single organization. And I've really learned firsthand. I've become very involved with the obesity organizations, and I've learned a great deal about how they view this problem, how people who are challenged with being overweight and obese think about this issue, and how we can communicate where arthritis plays a role there. I don't think that if I hadn't gotten involved in this coalition, I wouldn't be involved in this aspect of it. And it's taught us at the foundation a great deal, just as an example and one of the areas. The issue here is always to focus clearly on the target. We can go off in sidetracks all the time. There are many wonderful things to do. We're always having to say, what is our goal here? And focus back on that OA agenda and see where we're headed and is it what we really want to do. And the partnerships work best when they mobilize assets and respond to common opportunities. And this took some thinking and working together. How can I approach the obesity societies and make it in their interest to become involved with us? And that took some creative thought and working with people that would help us to think about that. And keep them aligned and keep them engaged. Now, we're beginning to focus. I think at first everybody is developing their sort of education sheets and the communication sheets, and now people are beginning to think about how they can move in the policy and advocacy arena as they're moving forward in many of the areas of the coalition. And finally, sustaining this seems to be harder than forming it. I say that personally. I think you've got to find a structure that really works because it's the structure that sometimes can really bring the house down. And you have to really think that through, make sure it continues to be the right structure, so reevaluating that structure. We just had a steering committee meeting of the OA Action Alliance and said, is it still working? Are these the right work groups? Do we need to have more or less? And though we're all nervous that, oh gosh, more, luckily, they didn't think that, but we have to have that on the table to think about that. And obviously, continuing to recruit and engage active organizations and thinking about where are we going to get that funding and making sure we keep focused on that OA agenda We bring it out, we quote it constantly, because people have fantastic ideas, really. And you'd like to do them all, but you have to keep focused with where you're going. So I want to end here. I really appreciate everybody's attention, that coming together is just a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. I think Henry Ford said it best, but I really have this on my wall, above my desk, thinking about this every day as we go forward and think about making these public health endeavors to make arthritis a key issue here. And I hope that you feel we've talked a little bit about arthritis. You've had the opportunity to hear the story around the Arthritis Foundation's approach to this crisis. And certainly with all our partners, we've developed all these ways of thinking about making arthritis a public health issue. And you've heard some of the challenges of really engaging the public, the policymakers, and sometimes people with arthritis about it. And that we've had some great opportunities and have great opportunities going forward. So I really want to thank the many people, healthcare professionals, Arthritis Foundation staff, and the many organizations who have brought their energy, funding, and expertise to people with arthritis. It's really made a huge difference. And I've had the privilege of being involved in that in these past many years. So thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions and hope that you don't feel as confused as this young lady looks. So thank you.
My name is Eugenia Smith, and I'm the chairperson for the Community Committee for Health Promotion. And my question is that the population that we serve the underserved, which are public housing residents in the city of Boston. And how is your outreach strategy going to reach the folks most in need? And my second question is that arthritis does affect many people. A lot of it's unreported in the population that I serve because there are so many other bigger issues that they think that are bigger. And so arthritis sometimes goes under the table, therefore is untreated because there's no cure. So why complain? Take a couple of pain pills and call it a day.
Right.
So how do you get that information out to that population that says there is some alternatives, there is some pain management? What is your strategy for that?
Well, thank you for your questions. They're both great ones. So a lot of what we're doing is trying to work through other organizations. So we would love to work with your organization and think together how to reach those underserved populations. We work heavily with the National Alliance for Hispanic Health, as well as African American churches. And the foundation does nationwide, but clearly we want to involve as many people as we can to be thinking about what is the best avenue. Because I don't have the answer, but together we certainly can think of ways of doing that. Your second question is the question. You know, how do you get people to pay attention to their health? And, you know, people always worry about the thing that's going to kill them, right? And when they don't realize that arthritis is actually right in there and making it harder for them to take care of their heart disease and diabetes. So a lot of the Ad Council campaigns and things that we're starting to do, we're working very closely with the American Diabetes Association to bring the arthritis message to their advocates and their population. So it's really through partnerships that we're beginning to think about this, but you bring very good questions to the table. That's what keeps all of us going every day. So no, I don't have the answer, but we certainly are trying to start a process to make a difference. So thank you for your questions.
I'm Mary Jane England. I'm chair of one of the public health departments here at Boston University. We are the community health sciences. We do a lot of social and behavioral work in the communities. One of BU's probably claim to fame is we tend to do things at the local level with the consumer, to find out how you can work with the consumers. One program that has been brought to our attention is Silver Sneakers. Silver Sneakers is a program that is funded by Medicare Advantage program, so it's fully funded for the seniors. It was very smart in that they went to health clubs and used the time middle of the day when people who work aren't going to be there, and have found it very effective. But some of the things, I'd like your opinion on this. One of the reasons it's effective, not only is it appropriate for people 65 and older with a lot of chronic illnesses, but a lot of arthritis, was the socialization. People coming together, and they all wear those sneakers. So we still call them sneakers. I don't think any of the young people call them sneakers anymore, but the silver sneakers, they felt an identity. And I don't know if you've done any work then with the consumers about how they can manage together in groups their illnesses.
Well, that's a great question. Clearly, the evidence-based programs that we work together with the CDC are on a group model, so people do come together. We actually have trouble people to leave the program. They want to stay in our aquatics program at the Y or our exercise program and so forth. So yes, we are working hard at that. I think we have been very cognizant that we want to have clear evidence that the programs work. We raise all our money from donors, and they ask us that. And so we've worked with the CDC. And so that's why we're being very careful, being sure that they really have been shown to make a difference, and that all these programs that we offer with the CDC do that. So yes, there are group models. As I mentioned, with Walk With Ease, you can have a group model, or you can just get the book and do it on your own. Men like to do that, as opposed to women who like to tend to get together. So yes, working in the community is a key part of this. But when you're thinking of the broad issues here, You can try to reach as many as people as you can. It takes a huge amount of effort and time. So you also want to do these things that affect environmental policy that are really going to change the context a little bit. So you need to do them together. So that's really, today we were sort of talking about not the community programs that we work very closely with the CDC on and the state health departments to deliver, along with the Y and many other partners, but really trying to think about changing the context, because we all know that smoking, people smoked, and you had a lot of programs that people went to, but some of the big game changers were when you changed those laws and said you couldn't smoke in hospitals and couldn't do things. So we're trying to work from both ends of that public health pyramid. Thank you for your question.
Thank you all of you for joining us, and we have a reception for you outside. Thank you.